Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Masters, a whole-by-whole history of America's Golf Classic, 3rd edition, by David Sowell, narrated by Barry Abrams. Introduction. 6 days before Christmas in 1933, it was announced that a new golf tournament would take place in the spring. The tournament would be held on a new course in Georgia, the Augusta National Golf Club, and it would be hosted by the club's founder, who happened to be the greatest golfer of all time, Bobby Jones. The game of golf has never been so enriched and has never been the same. Bobby Jones was one of the most celebrated figures in what was called the Golden Age of sports. From 1923 through 1929, he won 9 major golf titles. In 1930, he captured that era's Grand Slam by winning the British Amateur, the British Open, the United States Open, and the United States Amateur. Up until this incredible feat, no golfer had ever won more than 2 of these prestigious tournaments in a single year. In the fall of that year, after announcing his retirement from competition at the age of 28, Jones remained very much in the public eye. He signed on with Warner Brothers Studios to make golf instructional films that were shown in movie theaters across the country. The films were a huge success, allowing a whole generation of golfers to see his beautiful swing at actual speed and in slow motion. Jones had another endeavor he wanted to pursue, and that was to build what he called his dream course. In the spring of 1931, friends of Jones in Augusta, Georgia, suggested that he drive over from Atlanta, his hometown. The friends wanted him to look at a property, Fruitland's Nurseries, which was for sale. This 365-acre tract was once the site of an indigo plantation that had been purchased in 1857 by a Belgian baron named Louis Matthew Edward Berkmans. The baron, who was a horticulturist, and his son Prosper, a professional agronomist and horticulturist, had turned the old plantation into one of the South's finest commercial nurseries. When Jones came to the property to inspect it, he was driven down the impressive entranceway, Magnolia Lane, to the stately pre-Civil War manor house. He then walked around to the rear of the house and saw before him a beautiful canvas upon which to create his masterpiece. Stands of tall pines with flowers and shrubs and vast stretches of open ground that ran down a long hillside toward a stream, Ray's Creek. A deal for the property was struck, and soon afterward, the Augusta National Golf Club was formed. Jones was an exceptional achiever off the golf course as well. After he earned a degree in mechanical engineering at Georgia Tech in just 3 years, he received a B.S. degree from Harvard, where he had spent 2 years studying English literature. The son of a lawyer, Jones subsequently entered Emory University Law School in Atlanta. During his second year at Emory, he passed the Georgia bar exam and became a lawyer. What made Jones a truly exceptional man, in addition to his academic accomplishments, was that he had also been blessed with an attribute often in short supply in the population, the gift of common sense. While he had an abundance of knowledge about what was required to make a golf hole truly outstanding, he knew that he would need first-rate support if he was to make his dream course the great layout he wanted it to be. One of the first steps Jones took after the Augusta National Golf Club was organized and he had been named its president was to engage the services of renowned Scottish golf course architect Alistair Mackenzie. Jones had played Cypress Point on the Monterey Peninsula, one of the courses in the United States that Mackenzie had designed, and he had been deeply impressed. Another factor in Jones's selection of Mackenzie was that he wanted Augusta National to have the playing characteristics of the Scottish courses he had come to admire so much. Jones wanted the natural contours of the land to dictate the strategy of the holes. The fairways would be wide and quick. The fairway and greenside bunkers would be kept to a minimum, and the greens would be large, undulating, and fast. Another key player in the founding of Augusta National was Clifford Roberts, a Wall Street investment banker who handled the financing and operational details of the club. In a few short years, Roberts would display an as-yet untapped talent, which was showing the world how to put on a first-class golf tournament. The course formally opened for play in January 1933. Later that year, the inner circle of the club decided that beginning in the spring of 1934, the club would play host to an annual invitational tournament in which the top players in golf would participate. Cliff Roberts wanted the event to be called the Masters, but Jones thought the name too presumptuous. So the event took the official name of the Augusta National Invitational. But a large number of sports writers had picked up on Roberts' preferred name, and they referred to the tournament as the Masters from the very beginning. In 1938, Jones finally agreed to change the tournament's name to the Masters. The rise of the Masters, the youngest by far of golf's four major tournaments, is one of the great stories in American sports. The game's other three major events, the British Open, the United States Open, and the Professional Golfers Association of America Championship, were first played in 1860, 1895, and 1916, respectively. During the first full week in April, when the tournament annually takes place, millions of Americans who ordinarily can go right on living, even if they confuse a nine iron with scrap iron, suddenly become consumed with golf, golfers, and Augusta National. As for the millions of golfers and golf fans, it has been said there is a consciousness of the Masters in the air every day of the year. Because the Masters is the only one of professional golf's four major tournaments with a permanent home, the game's greatest players have played more holes of major championship golf at Augusta National than at any other course in the world. In the process, they have executed some of the game's greatest shots and have also, on many occasions, been humbled beyond belief. Each of the 18 holes on Bobby Jones's masterpiece is named for a plant or tree that adorns it, and they have all made their mark on what has been so aptly called the tournament like no other. This book will chronicle each of the individual holes' contributions to the excitement, pressure, heartbeat, and exhilaration that is the Masters. Hole number 1, par 4, 445 yards, tee olive. For 51 weeks of the year, the first tee at Augusta National is a serene and idyllic setting. But Thursday of Masters Week, and for the following 3 days, it becomes the center of the golf universe. Whether you are playing in your first Masters or your 21st, the first tee jitters here are like the tournament itself, as big as they get. When the players arrived for the 2006 Masters, they had to make an adjustment for the fact that the center of the golf universe had shifted slightly. The first tee had been moved back 10 yards, increasing the hole's distance from 435 to 445 yards. The change at the first hole was part of a package of changes made at Augusta National that also involved the lengthening and toughening of five other holes, 4, 7, 11, 15, and 17. This was the second time in 4 years there had been a host of changes at Augusta National. Before the 2002 Masters, three of the holes that were updated for the 2006 Masters, 1, 7, and 11, along with 8, 9, 10, 13, 14, and 18, had their tees pushed back in addition to other modifications. These changes were dictated by the increased length achieved by today's golfers, assisted greatly by their high-tech clubs and improved long-distance golf balls. As in 2002, the 2006 changes stirred up quite a bit of discussion and debate in the media, among the players, and among golf fans. Many believed this wonderful national treasure was being defiled. Others thought the changes were long overdue. As each hole's history will chronicle, the fact is the Augusta National course has always been a work in progress, from the day it opened in 1933. Bobby Jones designed and oversaw a number of changes before his death in 1971. Masters champions Ben Hogan, Byron Nelson, and Jack Nicklaus are just a few of the professionals who have also participated in making changes to the course. In addition to the players, noted golf course architects Perry Maxwell, George Fazio, Robert Trent Jones, and Tom Fazio, who oversaw the 2002 and 2006 changes, have assisted in designing and implementing improvements to Jones and McKenzie's original masterpiece. There was another change at the Masters in 2002 that was universally hailed, and it was one for which millions of golf fans had been clamoring for years: televising the play on the front nine during the final two rounds. Masters officials had long feared that televising the front nine would dilute the quality of the telecast, but the demands from the Masters faithful were too great to be ignored. The change called for almost all of the leaders' play to be covered on Saturday. On Sunday, coverage would start an hour earlier and show the leaders teeing off at the first hole. The first hole is a very demanding dogleg right uphill par 4, and it has experienced its share of changes over the years. For starters, it was originally the 10th hole when the club opened in 1933. The original layout posed a problem in winter because the first three holes were set on the lowest part of the course. In colder months, these holes were often covered by frost during the early morning hours, which delayed play. To alleviate this problem, the nines were reversed after the first Masters in 1934. Right off the bat, the first shot at the first hole presents the player with the risk versus reward scenario Jones loved to have on a hole. On this hole, the reward has always been for a drive that clears the large bunker on the right side of the fairway at the bend of the dogleg. If the shot is successful, the player has an ideal approach to the green with a short iron. If the shot comes up short, the player has what can be a very challenging second shot from the sand. The hole's distance has been lengthened over the years from its original 400 yards to keep the fairway bunker in play. In 1982, Masters officials decided to lengthen the hole by 10 yards and not tell the players about the increased length. The players picked up on the covert change in the practice round, when their drives began filling up the fairway bunker. The added distance certainly affected the scoring on the hole that year. The number of birdies dropped by almost 40%, and bogeys increased by more than 30%. There has always been one element that can make this shot a very risky proposition or a breeze, and that is the wind conditions. If the wind is at the player's back, he can really let one ride. But if it is in his face, he generally opts to take the safe route and play to the left center of the fairway to avoid the bunker. It used to be that if a player pulled his tee shot too far to the left, he was not overly concerned. Even if the ball rolled into the adjacent fairway of the ninth hole, he would still have a clear approach to the green. However, this avenue to the green has been taken away with the addition of more pine trees up that side of the fairway. The green is protected by a bunker on the left side, which was a 1951 addition. The putting surface is very undulating. It has a ridge on the back section that can make things very interesting if a player is long with his approach and has a lengthy putt or chip back down to the hole. This green has an abundance of subtle breaks that have always produced a very high number of missed putts from the 4 and 5 foot range. The pin is usually tucked behind the bunker once in an early round and in the final round. The locations of the pin in the other two rounds are typically right center and front right. In the 2001 Masters, the first had ranked as the second most difficult hole on the course. Its Tiger Woods ranking was also pretty high. Before the 2002 Masters, Woods had made only one birdie in 26 attempts at the hole. The changes made to the first prior to the 2002 Masters were increasing the length from a listed 410 yards to 435 yards, and extending the fairway bunker an additional 25 yards toward the green. These changes added an additional 50 yards to the carry a drive would need to clear the fairway bunker. Many players have encountered problems before they have even had a chance to place a tee in the ground at the first hole. In one of the Masters in the late 1960s, Bert Yancey got to the course with plenty of time to warm up and get ready for his opening round, but his caddy was nowhere to be found. Yancey had made what was, in hindsight, a big mistake. He had allowed the young man who had been assigned to him by the Augusta National caddy master to borrow his car the previous evening, and to make matters worse, his clubs were in the trunk. Yancey was practically hysterical. The assistant caddy master was hurriedly dispatched to locate the missing young man. He played a hunch and soon found the caddy and the vehicle at a brothel just a few miles from the club. He was able to get the clubs to Yancey in time for him to make his appointment at the first tee with a new caddy. In 1937, Harry Cooper, whose nickname was Hard Luck, was tied with the eventual winner Byron Nelson after the third round. The caddy who had worked so effectively with Cooper for 54 holes did not show up for the final round. Forced to use a replacement, Hard Luck shot his worst round of the tournament, a 74, to finish in third place, 4 strokes off the pace. Herman Kaiser, the surprise leader after the first 2 rounds in 1946 and the eventual winner, was enjoying a relaxing lunch in the clubhouse an hour before what he thought was his scheduled tea time until Henry Picard charged into the dining area. Picard, the 1938 Masters champion, frantically told Kaiser that he had just been called to the first tee. Kaiser raced out to the first tee without the benefit of any practice. Kaiser parred the hole and went on to post his third straight subpar round. Jimmy DeMeritt held the lead after the first 3 rounds in 1947, and he opted not to go to the practice range before the final round. Not because he didn't want to or need to, he just wasn't in any condition to swing a club. DeMeritt had been out partying the night before, and he was still feeling the effects of overconsumption of alcohol. Instead of practicing, he found a quiet, shady spot off the 10th fairway to use as his personal detoxification area until he was called to the tee. DeMeritt's tee shot at the first that day was far from spectacular. He slapped it out into some brush on the right side of the fairway. On his second shot, he managed to slice his ball around a group of pines onto the front of the green and then two-putted for his par. After a bogey at the second, DeMeritt settled down and finished the round at a 1-under-par 71 and won the tournament by 2 strokes. Before Sam Snead reached the first tee in his first Masters in 1937, he was advised he was being assessed a penalty. It wasn't a stroke penalty, but a financial one. His employer, the Greenbrier Resort at White Sulphur Springs, West Virginia, had advised him that he would be docked $10 a week's pay for being away from his duties as the resort's golf professional to play in the Masters. Snead's first appearance at Augusta did not get off to a good start, as he made bogey on his first hole. Snead finished the day at 4-over-par, 76. He played the second round at even par and the third round at 1-under. Snead stood the chance of easily recouping his financial penalty, but he ballooned to a 7-over-par 79 in the last round and finished 5 strokes out of the money, which in that year's tournament was paid to only the top 10 finishers. In spite of the fact that this was his 22nd Masters, Snead was a little too eager when it came time for him to tee off in the first round in 1961. He did not allow enough time for the pairing that had teed off ahead of him to clear the landing area. Snead's tee shot almost struck one of them, and it was not just anyone. It was an individual who at that time probably had the most nicknames of any player in the field. Those that can be said are Tantrum Tommy, Terrible Tommy, and Tempestuous Tommy. Snead had nearly struck the living legend of short fuses, Tommy Bolt. Bolt let loose with a verbal tirade back at Snead that almost peeled the bark off some of the pines lining the fairway. Bolt's verbal wrath must have still been ringing in Snead's ears when he got to the green, because he missed a 2-footer for his par. Arnold Palmer received a rousing welcome ovation from the gallery when he walked onto the first tee for the opening round in 1968. A few moments later, Masters officials told him that the ball he was playing was not welcome, and he would have to use another brand. This was particularly stinging to Palmer because the brand of the ball he was playing was the Arnold Palmer. Prior to the tournament, the United States Golf Association had ruled that the ball was illegal because it did not meet its specifications. After that ruling, Palmer's company had made the changes required for compliance and had been advised by the USGA the balls were now legal. When Palmer showed up at the first tee, however, his ball was one of 19 on a list of banned balls Masters officials had prepared. Palmer played his round with balls from two competing brands, Titleist and Maxfly, and shot an even par 72. By the start of the second day, the Masters officials were made aware that Palmer's ball was in fact now legal, and he used it in the second round. He may have wished he had played with the other two brands again, because he shot a 79 and missed the cut for the first time in his Masters career. Two competitors who had to tee off at the first hole under very difficult personal situations were Byron Nelson and Jack Nicklaus, and both went on to win the tournament. In Nelson's case, he had arrived at the first tee for his playoff with Ben Hogan in 1942 after a night of virtually no sleep. Nelson had a long history of chronic stomach trouble. During the night before, he had experienced one of his worst bouts ever with the problem, describing his stomach as churning like a washing machine. When Hogan saw how ill Nelson looked that morning, he offered to delay the playoff until the afternoon, but Nelson insisted they tee off that morning as originally scheduled. Nelson's tee shot at the first was probably the worst of his career. It could almost be defined as a shank. The ball shot out to the extreme right, flew over a concession stand, ricocheted off a pine tree, and came to rest under a little evergreen tree. His ball's position prevented him from addressing the ball as a right-handed player. He had to become a switch hitter and execute his next stroke with a left-handed stance. He used a putter and punched it back into play. His next shot flew over the green, and he took three more strokes to get down and started the day with a double bogey 6. Nelson would take several holes to recover from his stomach problem and then make a remarkable comeback to defeat Hogan. Nelson's physical problem would have to be considered mild in comparison to the emotional issues Jack Nicklaus was dealing with when he stepped onto the first tee for the first round in 1966. The day before, four of Nicklaus's Columbus, Ohio friends were killed when their private plane crashed in Tennessee while en route to Augusta. After a woefully hooked tee shot that ended up in the ninth fairway and an approach shot that left him almost 40 feet from the pin, Nicklaus somehow managed to find a way to deal with the tragic events of the previous 24 hours. He drained the putt for an opening birdie. It would take him an extra day, but Nicklaus would go on to claim the third of his six Masters titles in an 18-hole, three-way playoff with Gabe Brewer and Tommy Jacobs. Unlike golf's other three major championships, the Masters is strictly an invitation tournament sponsored by a private organization, the Augusta National Club. The club sets the qualifications for receiving an invitation. Doug Sanders probably put it best from a player's perspective about being invited to Augusta when he said, "If you don't get an invitation to the Masters, it is like being out of the world for a week." Like the course itself, the criteria for qualifying for an invitation have gone through many changes over the years. Being a winner or a top finisher in a major championship has always been a means of qualifying. For a number of years, winning a Professional Golfers Association PGA Tour event has automatically qualified a player. Also, at one time, the prior Masters champions selected one player by ballot from a list of players who were not otherwise qualified. The best way for a player to ensure he is in the field each year is to win the Masters, because prior champions are granted a lifetime invitation. Besides being a former Masters champion or qualifying through a major championship, the other two primary means of qualifying are by being in the top 50 in the world golf rankings or being in the top 40 money winners on the PGA Tour from the previous year. Also, The top 16 finishers from the previous year's Masters are invited back the next year. To give the tournament an international flavor, the invitation committee has often issued special invitations to foreign players. In 1957, Cliff Roberts received a letter from a man in Johannesburg, South Africa, seeking an invitation for his 22-year-old son. The man stated that his son was a great admirer of Bobby Jones and always had an ambition to play in the Masters. He said his son did not have the money for the trip, but if he were extended an invitation, he would pass the hat around among friends to get the necessary funds. The letter moved Roberts, although the man's son did not have an especially strong record. Roberts took up the matter with the committee and had voted to extend the young man an invitation. Roberts then wired the father and advised him to go ahead and pass the hat because an invitation was on the way. Gary Player was the young man they were passing the hat for in Johannesburg, and in that 1957 Masters, he would finish in a very respectable 25th place. In 1961, Player would win his first of three green jackets. The first hole was crucial for Player in that one-stroke victory, as he made birdies here in three out of the four rounds. Since the incorporation of the world rankings into the invitation criteria, these special invitations have become less numerous. Recent recipients of a special invitation have been Ryo Ishikawa of Japan in 2013 and Shubhankar Sharmar of India in 2018. The most interest in a player making his first appearance at the first tee was in 1975, when Lee Elder became the first black athlete to play in the Masters. In the late 1960s, a controversy began brewing over the fact that a black player had never qualified for the Masters, and there were increasing calls that a special invitation be issued. In March 1973, a group of 18 congressmen wrote Cliff Roberts and requested that a special invitation be extended to Elder. This was 2 years after the death of Bobby Jones. Roberts was now solely in charge of Augusta National and the Masters. Roberts declined the calls for a special invitation, stating that when a black player did qualify, he would by all means be extended an invitation. The calls for the special invitation continued after the 1973 Masters, but Roberts remained fixed on his position. The controversy ended when Elder qualified for the 1975 Masters by winning a PGA Tour event and received his invitation as Roberts had stated he would. When Elder stepped onto the first tee that morning, a light rain was falling, but the fairway was lined with spectators from tee to green. Elder seemed very relaxed on the tee. He teed up his ball and smoothly launched his first drive. It split the fairway. He put his second shot safely on the green and two-putted for a routine par. He picked up his first Masters birdie on the second hole and finished the day with a 74. He didn't make the cut that year, but he would play in six more Masters. His best finish would be 17th place in 1979. It is often hard to judge what kind of round a player is going to have by his score at the first hole. In the third round in 1986, Nick Price's drive did not clear the bunker. His shot from the sand still left him almost 80 yards to the green. He hit a wedge to within about 20 feet and two-putted for bogey. Price then went on a tear, recording 10 birdies over the remaining 17 holes to shoot a 9-under par 63. This broke the single-round record for the Masters of 64, which had been established by Lloyd Mangrum in 1940. When he started his last round in 1990, Nick Faldo had probably pushed far back in his memory the double bogey six he had had at the first hole in the third round in 1989. Faldo had eventually fought his way back from that disaster. He was never in the lead outright in that tournament, but by the time he had putted out on the 72nd hole, he had a share of it. Faldo went on to win his first green jacket in a sudden-death playoff with Scott Hoke. Now a year and 1 day later, Faldo was coming off a splendid third round of 66 and was just 2 strokes behind leader Raymond Floyd. Faldo would have normally played a draw from right to left. On this day, there was a crosswind blowing from left to right, however, which made him reluctant to attempt that shot. He decided instead to play his shot to the left center of the fairway and let the wind bring it back to the landing area. The shot did not come off as he had planned, and he pushed his drive into the fairway bunker. Faldo's 7-iron second shot from the trap was more the type you would expect from an 18 handicapper than the defending Masters champion. He got it out of the bunker, but advanced his ball only about 50 yards. His wedge to the green was of the high handicapper variety as well, and he left himself 35 feet to the right of the hole. The green here is no place to be lying that distance from the pin in two, much less in three. His nightmarish start continued as he three-putted from that distance and walked off the green with an opening double bogey. Faldo may not have looked a Masters champion on the first hole, but he played the remaining 17 holes like one. For the second straight year, he battled his way into a first-place tie and then won a sudden-death playoff. This time, his playoff victim would be Raymond Floyd. In 1996, the first hole did provide a preview to what would be the most unexpected final round finish in Masters history. Greg Norman had dominated the tournament since the first round, when he birdied 9 of the last 12 holes to shoot a 63 and tie Price's record for a low round score. After the second round, Norman was in the lead and Faldo in second place, 4 strokes behind him. The two were paired for the third round, and Norman extended his lead to 6 strokes. It truly looked as if it was finally going to be Norman's year, and that the final round would be a coronation ceremony for him. Norman, who was again paired with Faldo, pulled his opening drive and missed the fairway to the left. He came up short with his approach shot, and it fell in the greenside bunker. Faldo drove the ball perfectly to the center of the fairway. His 9-iron approach landed in the center of the green, about 20 feet from the hole. Norman's bunker shot was a solid one, finishing 4 feet to the right of the hole. Faldo's putt for birdie missed by 2 feet, and he tapped in for his par. Norman's putt was one of those in that dreaded 4 to 5 foot range that the first is notorious for in the number of misses it generates from that distance. Norman became another one of its victims, as he missed his effort on the high side. The day would only get worse for Norman. After starting the day 6 in front of Faldo, he would end it 5 strokes behind him in second place. The all-time best start of a contender in the Masters in the final round would have to be by Roberto DiVincenzo in 1968. DiVincenzo hailed from Buenos Aires, Argentina, and had been part of the international contingent of players at the Masters for many years. He had won 140 tournaments worldwide, but had just claimed his first major the previous July when he won the British Open. He made his first appearance at Augusta in the 1950 Masters and never had any real success until 1967, when he finished tied for 10th. At the start of play in the final round in 1968, he was just 2 strokes behind the leader, Gary Player, and 1 stroke behind 4 other players, who were tied for 2nd. At the first tee, he uncorked a big drive and had a 9-iron left to the green. The pin was positioned on the front left side, tucked in behind the bunker. DiVincenzo hit a splendid-looking approach shot with a 9-iron. The shot cleared the bunker by about 10 feet, hopped once, and then rolled into the hole for an eagle two. It was already a special day. It was DiVincenzo's 45th birthday, and now he was tied for the lead in the final round of the Masters. The gallery sang happy birthday to him as he walked to the second tee. In about 3.5 hours, what had started out as the greatest day of his career would turn into the most tragic ever experienced at a major championship. DiVincenzo would shoot the round of his life, only to be knocked out of a playoff for the green jacket by an errant stroke. Not with a golf club, but with a pencil. The events of that dark day will be covered in greater detail in chapters 10, 17, and 18. Strange things go on at Augusta National. 1,000,000-to-1 shots go in the hole. Golf balls disappear before the eyes of the television audience, The wind sometimes seems to be blowing in two different directions at the same time. A pimento cheese sandwich tastes out of this world, and patrons are not gouged on beer prices. To further establish this point, here are two prime examples from the first hole. In the 2016 opening round, Ernie Els, a four-time major winner, played a good drive off the tee. His approach shot was a little off, leaving him with a chip shot of 60 feet. Ernie's chip finished 3 feet from the hole. As he took his putter from his caddy and prepared for what he hoped would be a one-putt par, no one in the throng surrounding the green could have fathomed what they were about to witness. El's par attempt from 3 feet went 2 feet by the hole. His bogey putt rolled past the hole and again stopped in the 2-foot range. His double bogey effort finished 4 feet past the hole. Ernie's next putt left him a foot away. From this tap-in range, he putted one-handed and missed. He had about the same distance remaining. Using the one-handed stroke again, he finally got it in the hole for a 9, the highest score ever recorded at the first hole in the tournament's history. The Masters staffers doing the electronic scoring gave Ernie a 10. Their error was corrected after the round. Els finished the round with an 8-over-par score of 80. He had a chance at a 79, but he missed a 2-footer at 18 for par. When asked in the press room how he was able to carry on after his opening hole debacle, Ernie said, "I don't know how I stayed out there, but you love the game, and you got to have respect for the tournament." In the second round in 1979, Mac McClendon's approach shot missed the green and flew into the gallery, striking a woman in the head. The dazed woman was taken to the first aid station and then on to the hospital for x-rays. After the woman checked out all right at the hospital, she returned to the course and started following Mac McClendon again. It wasn't because she now felt she had a special bond with him. She already had that, for she was Mrs. Mac McClendon. Hole number 2. Par 5, 575 yards. Pink dogwood. Every player who steps onto the tee at the second hole is thinking birdie at this dogleg left par 5, although it is the longest hole on the course. From the tee, the fairway slides gradually down until, approximately 300 yards out, it takes a left turn at the crest of a very steep slope. The elevation drops some 90 feet from tee to green, but most of that descent occurs in the last 275 yards. This hole originally measured 525 yards. Its distance has been increased several times over the years. The last lengthening came before the 1999 Masters, when it was stretched from 550 to 575 yards. If a player opts to take the short route down the left side on his tee shot, he must guard against getting into the woods, which are just off the fairway. Also, he must be aware of the ravine that is concealed behind the trees that has swallowed up the hopes of many a Masters participant. In 1985, amateur John Inman was off to a great start. Inman had shot a 2-under par 70 in the first round, and he had parred the first hole to start his second round. Inman had birdied the second in the first round, and he was undoubtedly thinking birdie again, but he hooked his drive into the woods on the left side. His ball came to rest against an azalea bush. Inman's next swing failed to move the ball, so he then elected to take a drop. His next stroke got him out into the fairway, and two shots later, he was in a greenside bunker. Inman's blast from the sand still left him 6 feet from the hole, and he two-putted for a 9. To his credit, Inman fought off the effects of his visit to the left side woods, and he played the rest of the round at even par. The highest score ever at the second hole occurred after a drive visited the left side woods in the first round in 1948. Sammy Bird was the guilty party. Bird was a former Major League Baseball player who had played on Augusta's minor league team while working his way up to the big leagues. Bird had spent most of his time in the majors with the New York Yankees, where he was tagged with the nickname Babe Ruth's Caddy. Ruth was in the latter stages of his career with the Yankees at that time, and Bird's chief duties were to pinch run for Ruth and take over for him defensively in the late innings. Bird also took a good deal of money out of Ruth's pocket on the golf course. After retiring from baseball, he decided to become a professional golfer, and he had a very successful career. His best finish at Augusta was third in 1941. The 1948 Masters was his last appearance at Augusta, and it is one he would undoubtedly like to have forgotten. After opening with a par at number one, he paid a visit to the woods on the left with his drive at the second, and when it was all said and done, he had recorded a 10. 58 years later, in 2006, David Duval tied Bird's mark at the second. Duval, who was coming off a double bogey at the first hole, duck-hooked his drive at the second deep into the pines on the left side. It was four strokes and two penalty strokes later before he could reach a greenside bunker. He then blasted out and two-putted for his record-equaling quintuple bogey. In the final round in 2003, Phil Mickelson made a remarkable recovery after pushing his drive into the pines on the left side. The errant shot left him with an unplayable lie. After taking a drop, he took out his driver with the hope of reaching one of the bunkers in front of the green. With his ball sitting on pine straw, Phil hit a perfect cut shot, and to his own surprise, the ball reached the front edge of the green. He was still 90 feet from the pin, but after studying the putt at length, he followed up his remarkable recovery shot with a remarkable putt that did a little ring around the lip of the cup before falling in. Mickelson, who was 0 for 42 in majors for his career, was now just three strokes off the lead at that point. When that putt dropped for a birdie, he looked skyward as if to ask, "Is this going to be my year?" But he would have to wait 12 more months for that first major title and a green jacket, as he would finish the day in third place, two strokes out of first. Driving down the right side of the fairway was originally a relatively safe play on this hole. In 1966, a bunker was added there at the suggestion of golfing legend Gene Sarazen. Sarazen made the shot heard round the world at the par 5 15th in the 1935 Masters, which will be detailed later in Chapter 15. He did not play in the first Masters owing to previous commitments, but the first time he played the course in 1935, he was not impressed because he believed several holes were too weak. Sarazen was impressed with the way Bobby Jones accepted criticisms of the course and the way he sought suggestions from players on ways to improve it. But it is hard to please everyone. Another golfing legend, Ben Hogan, disapproved of Sarazen's site selection for the bunker. Hogan thought the bunker should have been on the left side of the fairway. It should be noted that Hogan played a left-to-right fade on his drives, and the new trap put a ball with that type of flight path in jeopardy. Even before the last lengthening, the second hole gave up eagles sparingly, as evidenced by the fact that Tiger Woods is still seeking his first eagle at this hole. In the 1976 Masters, three eagles were recorded at the second hole. Two of those were by the pairing of Ben Crenshaw and Jack Nicklaus in the second round, and both were set up by outstanding second shots. Crenshaw brought a four-wood in from 260 yards and had rolled to within 8 feet of the pin. Nicklaus followed with one of his patented high three-iron shots from 220 yards. It nestled down 10 feet from the hole. It was Crenshaw's first career eagle at the second in his Masters career that began in 1972, and it was only Nicklaus's second in a Masters career that began in 1959. An eagle at the second hole in the first round was a key part of Sam Snead's first Masters win in 1949. It helped propel him to a three-stroke victory. The 1949 Masters was the first year a green jacket was presented to the winner. Snead slipped on the first one, and it soon became the most coveted garment in golf. Eagles were more plentiful in the early Masters, but this green's defenses have been substantially bolstered over the years. Originally, there was a bunker only on the right side of the green. In 1946, a second bunker was added on the left side, but there was still a wide opening in front of the green, which allowed players to run their shots onto it. Over the years, these bunkers have been deepened and expanded significantly, and the distance between them greatly reduced. The opening between the two that would allow a player to run a shot onto the green is now only about 50 feet wide. Ken Venturi proved in 1960, however, that landing in the greenside bunkers in two was not necessarily a bad thing. In each of the four rounds, he was in one of the bunkers and ended up playing the hole 5 under par for the tournament. In the first round, he holed out from the sand for eagle, and in the other three rounds, he got up and down for birdie. The green is approximately 120 feet across. It is very narrow on both the left and the right sides and features a ridge running across the back section. It has a wide middle, which is the safe play, but the surface is usually rather firm and can be hard to hold. The green slants from the rear to the front and slopes from left to right. One of Bobby Jones's guiding principles for par fives was that they be reachable with two excellently hit shots. Getting on the green is just half the battle at Augusta, however. For a number of years, the head professional at Augusta National automatically qualified to play in the Masters. Ed Dudley was the head professional at Augusta from 1933 to 1957. In the opening round of the 1935 Masters, Dudley reached the second hole in two shots, but three-putted for par. Dudley would also reach the other three par fives in two that day, and three-putted them as well. The second hole was the last of the par fives at Augusta National to surrender a double eagle. It came in the 76th edition of the Masters in 2012. In the previous 75 editions, there had been a number of close calls. The two players who had come the closest were Cary Middlecoff and Jack Nicklaus. The second shot that found the bottom of the cup at the second was by 29-year-old Louis Oosthuizen of South Africa. It came in the final round and was the fourth double eagle in Masters history. Besides the three other double eagles, there have been many shots holed for eagles on par fours and a number of holes in one on par threes. Louis' double eagle from 253 yards outdistanced them all, making it the longest shot ever holed in the Masters. Louis had laced a long drive from the tee and selected a 4-iron for his second shot. Although the shot was a good one, it initially appeared as if its result would leave him with a long putt for eagle. Its flight ended at about 210 yards at the opening between the bunkers at the front of the green, but its journey would continue for a good while. The hole was cut on the far right side of the green and 129 feet from where Louis' ball landed. From there, it took a hard right turn. At what could best be described as an unhurried pace, it rolled and rolled until it fell into the hole. The shot took Louis from 2 strokes behind to a shot in the lead. He would ultimately finish in a tie with Bubba Watson. He would lose the playoff as a result of Watson pulling off a phenomenal shot that would join Louis' double eagle of several hours earlier as one of the greatest shots ever in the Masters. It will be detailed later in Chapter 10. As stated at the end of Chapter 1, strange things happen at Augusta National. One of the second hole's contributions to this realm happened to Phil Mickelson in the final round in 2010. Phil was in a battle with Lee Westwood for the top spot. Phil had a delicate downhill birdie putt from 6 feet. Just as Phil was taking his putter back, a bud from one of Augusta National's pines landed, as though laser-guided, directly in his line. Given the circumstances of the putt, his ball was traveling at a slow pace. When it struck the bud, it tumbled offline to the left, and he had to settle for a tap-in par. With that kind of bad fortune, one would have had to wonder at that point if this wasn't going to be Phil's day. But he turned in a stellar performance over the rest of the round to win his third green jacket. In another example from this category at the second is what happened to Gene Sarazen in the first round in 1953. Sarazen was assessed a 2-stroke penalty when his drive struck his caddy. No explanation has been unearthed about how this exactly happened. If there had been a wait at the tee, the caddy could have walked on ahead so he could signal back to the tee when the group ahead of them was out of the way. Or perhaps he was intending to keep an eye on Sarazen's drive in case it strayed out of the fairway and into the woods. In any event, he was definitely in the wrong place at the wrong time, and Sarazen picked up a double bogey as a result. Since there will be a number of stories about the actions of caddies in the chapters that follow, now would be a good time to provide some background on the two different caddying periods in the Masters. From the first Masters in 1934 through the rain-plagued 1982 version, a Masters participant had to use a black caddy provided by Augusta National. Most of this caddy corps were known by their colorful nicknames, such as Reindeer, Stovepipe, First Baseman, and Cemetery. Two of the most famous caddies to emerge from the Augusta National caddy shack were Nathaniel Avery and Willie Peterson. In 1955, 19-year-old Nathaniel Avery reported to the caddy master at Augusta National looking for a bag for the Masters. Jackie Burke, Gene Littler, and Mike Suchak were the players who were thought by the caddy corps to have the most heat and were the most coveted assignments. Avery was fortunate enough not to be given one of the hot bags. He received one that was about as cold as it could get because it belonged to one of the first-timers in the field. The caddy master told Avery that if he gave him this bag, he would have to keep it. Avery said he would. He kept the bag for the next 14 years and became the best-known caddy in the country since that cold bag belonged to Arnold Palmer. Avery was nicknamed Iron Man. Masters lore tells us that he got the name because he could always pick out the right iron for his player to hit. But in a 1974 interview, he told a reporter that a fellow caddy called Charlie Boy gave him the name because he was like an Iron Man on the course. Charlie must have witnessed Iron Man with Palmer's bag during a practice round, which has been said to look as if it contained 41 clubs instead of the usual 14. Avery was with Palmer for all of his four Masters victories, and during Masters week, he came to be interviewed and photographed nearly as much as his famous boss. Willie Peterson started caddying in the Masters as a 16-year-old in 1949, but he never caddied for the same golfer for more than 1 year. In 1959, his string of one-year stands ended when he picked up the bag of a young amateur by the name of Jack Nicklaus, who was making his first Masters appearance. Peterson would carry clubs for Nicklaus for the next 23 Masters. Nicklaus would pick up five of his six Masters wins with Peterson on his bag. These five caddy victories tied Peterson with Pappy Stokes for bringing home the most winners. Stokes's victories took place in three different decades and for four different players: 1938, Henry Picard; 1948, Claude Harmon; 1951, Ben Hogan; 1953, Hogan again; and 1956, Jack Burke Jr. Peterson was probably the most animated caddy in Augusta history. He was always trying to coax Nicklaus's ball into the hole when he was tending the pin, twisting his body, waving his arms, and yelling. He would jump up and down and dance when Nicklaus holed a long putt. With Augusta National open only 6 months out of the year and almost all the membership residing elsewhere, the amount of play the course receives is very light, and the number of caddies it can support is actually very small. The caddy pool was never large enough to cover the entire Masters field, so caddies were brought in from other Georgia and South Carolina country clubs to lend a hand. Even with the out-of-town reinforcements, the caddy master had trouble meeting the demand, and a player could end up being assigned a very young and inexperienced caddy, or one whose breath indicated he was caddying while impaired. As the purses grew and the caddying profession evolved, there were growing calls from players that they be allowed to use their own caddies. The pressure continued to build and came to a head in 1982. The first round was played in an almost steady rain. By early afternoon, the gallery at the 13th hole was paying more attention to the caddies than the players because nearly half of them were slipping and falling into the mud trying to negotiate the rain-slickened fairway with their heavy bags. This was an ironic foreshadowing of the Augusta Caddy Corps demise. By 4 p.m. that day, with half the field still on the course, play had to be suspended because the back nine had become unplayable. The golfers who had not finished their round were told that play would resume at 7:30 the next morning. The players showed up at the appointed hour, but a large number of caddies did not. To compound an already bad situation, many golfers discovered that their equipment had been put away wet the night before. This was one of the biggest embarrassments Masters officials had ever experienced. Tom Watson spearheaded a renewed call by the players that they be allowed to use their regular caddies. Watson pleaded their case to the tournament chairman at the time, Hord Hardin, who was a retired lawyer. "Suppose you had to go into your biggest trial and you were told you couldn't use your own legal secretary. That's what it's like for us at Augusta." Hardin's answer wasn't long coming. It was soon announced that in 1983, the players would be allowed to use their own caddies in the Masters. From 1934 through 1975, if a tie occurred in the Masters, it would be settled by a playoff the day after the final round. The first playoff occurred in 1935 between Gene Sarazen and Craig Wood, which Sarazen won, and was contested over 36 holes. Subsequent playoffs were 18 holes in length until the format was changed to sudden death in 1976. The last 18-hole playoff occurred in 1970 between Billy Casper and Gene Littler, and it was all but decided at the second hole. Both players were heavyweights. Casper had won two United States Opens, and Littler had United States Open and the United States Amateur Championships to his credit. To add a little more spice to the playoff, they were both from San Diego and had competed regularly against each other as teenagers. Casper jumped out into the lead with a birdie at the first hole, but then hooked his tee shot at the second into the woods on the left side. Littler's drive was solid and in the fairway. Casper's lie in the woods was terrible. He was barely able to get his club on the ball, and his swing was going to be hampered by the Augusta National foliage that virtually surrounded him. Also, he had to get the shot up quickly because there was a fallen tree limb just in front of his ball. Casper was going to need some luck just to get the ball back in the fairway. He took a big cut with a lofted club, and a cloud of pine needles, grass, and small limbs sprayed into the air along with his ball, which came out cleanly and landed safely in the fairway. Littler almost reached the green with his second shot, leaving it just a few yards behind the bunker on the right side of the green. Casper's third shot just missed the green. It looked as if Littler was going to leave the second hole at least even with Casper and possibly one stroke ahead. All he had to do was pitch his third ball over the bunker and onto the green. Littler was known as Gene the Machine, but he stripped a gear on this shot. He flubbed it, and the shot flew only a few feet and landed in the bunker. Littler collected himself and then blasted his ball out of the sand and two-putted for a bogey. Casper got down from the fringe in two for a par and moved two strokes ahead. Casper carried his momentum from the second hole to the third as he picked up a birdie there to Littler's par and moved to a three-stroke lead. Casper was in control for the rest of the round. By the 11th hole, he was seven strokes ahead, and then he practically coasted home from there and ultimately won by five strokes. Nick Faldo had become interested in golf at the age of 13. During his Easter vacation from school, he watched something on his family's new color television set that he found captivating.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.